It's time for the Bill Ferguson Show.
This is Phil Ferguson, and you are listening to the cleverly titled The Phil Ferguson Show, show number 503. Can't believe that I've gotten to 503 episodes, halfway to 1,000. Only another decade to get there, I guess. But in this show, there's a lot. So the opening comments here are going to be brief. We do have coming up the Polaris Plan 2024 Part 2. Four, we're going to talk about diversification and using international versus domestic stock funds, stock index funds. I have a segment before that on our recent travel to Colorado and our time at the FFRF Conference in Denver, Colorado, and more thoughts on the upcoming CSIcon from the Center for Inquiry. Skeptical Inquiry Magazine. I hate their nomenclature, but the conference is called CSIcon. Go check it out. It's in Vegas. Just a couple weeks after this show goes live, so don't miss out. The show is going to be like 90 plus minutes, but how do you trim content that is this good? And then after all of that, which should be enough for the average show, right? But I'm not going to give you average. I'm going to give you way the fuck above average. We have a nice, juicy interview with the two authors of the book called Goodbye Religion, The Causes and Consequences of Secularization. And it's Ryan T. Cragun and Jesse M. Smith. And this will also be one of the very first, if not the first time, where I'm going to do an alternate thing, I guess, on YouTube, because I recorded the interview using Zoom. Now, if you go watch the video and you have any ideas and suggestions of how I can improve the video, of course, you can email me, phil@polarisfinancialplanning.com. The one thing I couldn't figure out is how to have all three of us on the screen at the same time. I know it's a function. I'm so much a newbie that I don't know. So instead, Zoom goes to whoever is speaking at the moment. It still works. It's still fine. I think I would like the three screen better. Of course, some fancy video production would be cool, but I don't have the skills for that. It's very new. Let me know what you think. Did you like the video? What can I do to change it, to improve it? Send me an email, like I said. And so we have all of that coming up. So this is going to be short. We're going to take a break and get into the action.
Do you mind spending 30 seconds on dark matter just for the heck of it? So when we observe galaxies, we find that they're spinning around at such a rate that stars on the edge should be flung outwards, sort of like water droplets on a bicycle wheel that's spinning fast, water gets flung out. Yeah. But the stars aren't getting flung out. Something must be holding them in. We don't see anything that can do that, but we know gravity has the power to hold things together. So we imagine that maybe there's some matter out there that we don't see, dark matter, that's why we don't see it, it doesn't give off light, and that matter is exerting a gravitational pull holding those stars together in these spinning galaxies. And when we make that hypothesis, it explains observation so spectacularly well that we begin to gain confidence that maybe the stuff that we haven't yet seen and we haven't yet touched or smelled yet, maybe it's real. So we build big detectors and we try to capture one of these dark matter particles. We haven't succeeded yet, but I think that we will. So this is a beautiful example of how observations drive rational thinking to explain the facts and ultimately verify it through observation and experiment that can be replicated. That is what science is.
If you have been following along on my social media, you may know that I just spent a week, maybe 10 days, 12 days, in and around Colorado. We flew out to Albuquerque, New Mexico, got a rental car, and oh my God, do rental cars cost so much fucking money now? I mean, it's one of those things, you'll instantly sound old when you say rental cars used to cost, or any of this used to cost, or I mean, back in my day, but here I am doing it. Rental cars, 20, 30, 40, 50 bucks a day. Now it's like 100 bucks a day. It's a real buzzkill. But we flew to Albuquerque, drove up to southwestern Colorado, visited there, went to Durango. Absolutely fun place to visit. Unfortunately, that was the one day we had rain in Durango, so our visit there got cut a little short. But visited there and then drove up through our mountains, around the mountains, some high valleys, went through a place. My wife was driving, so I was checking my phone. I think it's called Wolf Creek Pass and Wolf Creek Ski Resort. And because of the mountains, the geology, the topology, the weather patterns, for whatever reason, that specific location, being a higher altitude, gets about 400 inches of snow per year. And I'm sure that's the case for many of the famous ski locations in Colorado. They're really high elevation. We went 30 miles further north, and I don't remember the name of the city off the top of my head, and I checked how much snow that location gets in a winter, and it was 40 inches of snow. So just a 30-mile difference. You go from 40 inches of snow, where it's semi-arid, not quite desert, but semi-arid, high elevation, not real high, but you know, a mile above sea level versus 2 miles above sea level, and you go from 40 inches to 400 inches over a span of 30 miles. Absolutely fantastic. We visited Colorado, or we visited Denver, got to go to a few places there, got to eat some dinner. We went to an Italian restaurant, the name escapes me now, but the food was amazing until we got to the desserts. A real buzzkill. Absolutely. A couple people got the tiramisu. Just awful. Absolutely awful. I had, you know, because every once in a while, even though I'm type 2 diabetic, I can have a dessert. And mine was called the chocolate caramel brownie. But what they brought out was chocolate cake. And it wasn't good chocolate cake. It was dry, not quite as dry as putting sand in your mouth, but not good. And the chocolate frosting on it, I don't know. Oh, I'm not a cooking person. I think it's marzipan, the stuff that you see in all these baking shows or whatever, when they make cakes or desserts, that it looks really pretty and it's like almost like a silky fabric they can put on it. But I don't like the taste of it, and it was dry. I never did find the caramel, and then it had a scoop of ice cream, which I guess I didn't know because I didn't read the description of the dessert well enough. The ice cream was freezer burned, so it tasted like old freezer or old refrigerator. Now, since I'm type 2 diabetic, if it's not really fucking good, I'm just not eating it. So after a couple sample bites of that, it was easy for me to just go, I'm not eating it. So yay for my reduced sugar consumption because of that. Of course, at the end of this, we also went to Pikes Peak, Colorado, what they call America's Mountain. I don't know why, but it's Pikes Peak. It's easy to get to. It's just a little bit south of Denver in Colorado Springs, or next to Colorado Springs. What a fun trip. We took the train up, you know, a leisurely 1 hour and 10 minute train ride up. You have only 40 minutes there and an hour and 10 back. Unfortunately, my wife at the at the top had altitude sickness and just did not feel good. It can hit you. Thankfully, it didn't bother me. And I got a whole bunch of really cool pictures. The air was kind of hazy, so the pictures aren't as clear as I might have liked. But what a fun thing to visit. And after about 20 minutes of the 40 minutes there, my wife was feeling better. So she got to see some of the scenery, and we got to check out the store. And the store, it looked like it was sad. It was sad and pathetic. The store at the top of Pikes Peak when we were there looked like one of those stores that was closing out in an abandoned shopping mall that only had 10% stores in it. And they were just a week or two from closing. And there was like 10%, 15% product in that store. It was really, I wanted to buy something from Pikes Peak, but there was nothing that I wanted there. And there was not even much there to look at. And then we, of course, rode the train back down. One of the things, of course, I noticed very, very dramatically being in Colorado, how dry, at least this time of year, how dry it is, especially compared to Florida. And I have kind of gotten a little used to the moderate humidity inside my house and maybe even the high humidity, which it still is right now, outside. But there, so dry, my arms and legs became dry and itchy. I had to constantly put on chapstick, and you have to make sure you drink a lot of water, because if you perspire or if you do something where you should be sweating, you are sweating, but it evaporates so fast, it doesn't feel like you're sweating. So you can get dehydrated. We had a lot of days of 10, 15, 20% humidity. I think it might be lower in, you know, southern Utah or Phoenix or Las Vegas, where you'll be in the teens or the single digit humidities. But for us, this was a big difference. Thankfully, the last hotel that we stayed in for the Freedom From Religion Foundation conference, they had an in-room little portable humidifier, and we filled that with water and turned that on. Oh my God, what a difference. Absolute joy. Thank you to the downtown Sheraton for having a humidifier in the room that we could fill with water and make the humidity go up, at least in the hotel room. Absolutely brilliant. And of course, that brings me to the part where we were at the FFRF, Freedom From Religion Foundation Conference, that sold out. They had only room for 600 people, and they sold 600 tickets, which is a joy for me to hear. I'd really rather that they had 1,000 people, but it was very full. Seating was a challenge. At one point, the hotel added some more chairs because not everybody wants to sit to everybody next to everybody. And I, as one of a person who is larger than average, so when they put the chairs next to each other, the thin chairs, my shoulders don't fit. And if there's someone of my size next to me, we definitely don't fit. So they added chairs to make it more comfortable for people. But what a great location, a great environment. The speakers were amazing, every single one of them. And I've been to so many conferences, I don't know how many, maybe 100 over the last 15 years or 18 years. So I know a lot of the speakers, and even a couple of the speakers did a talk that I've already seen, but it was so good I didn't mind. So very inspirational, very motivational. It makes me want to do more, because we live in a world where 35 to 40% of the population, and I'm going to get more political than FFRF could be because they're a 501c3, but 35 to 40% of the population maybe thinks that Trump is a good businessman. A generous portion of the population in the United States of America, and I'm going to have more on that when I go to the Center for Inquiries conference, which is called CSIcon in Las Vegas in just a couple weeks. How do people not understand how these things work? How can people share these memes or ideas or these conspiracy theories that to someone who has even just a moderate understanding of how the world works, look at that and just be able to discount it and know that it's false right out of hand. But yet there's a generous part of our population. And maybe that's always been the case. But that concerns me. And one of the topics, one of the speakers was about the vouchers and school vouchers and private schools. If you think that vouchers are there to provide school choice, please forgive me for saying it this way. You're an idiot. That's not what it's about. It's about two things. One, religious control. Some people want to have their kids raised up in a religious environment and not exposed to reality. So they want a private religious school, and they want a private religious school that they don't have to pay for. Who doesn't, right? So that's vouchers. It's one bad part of vouchers. There is also the corporate aspect where someone who's a friend of Betsy DeVos wants to run a private school and have it be a profit center for them where they can make money off the education, the miseducation, the lack of education of the students. Their concern is not education, but making a big profit, a big margin is their goal. Like healthcare, I don't think education should be a profit center for millionaires, multimillionaires, or billionaires to make even more money while at the same time stunting, limiting the intellectual capacity and experience and education for thousands, tens of thousands, or even millions of Americans, because we need everyone to be on the top of their game for the storms that are coming, the problems that we are creating, probably most of which I won't be around for when they get to their worst. I mean, I hope to be here for a very long time, but it's going to be worse 100 years from now than it is 30 years from now. So I think we all have a moral and ethical obligation. So that was why I was so delighted to see so many of the speakers. Someone who I think I can call a friend, Brandon Wolf, who used to live, I think he still does live in Orlando, and was one of the survivors of the Pulse nightclub attack where a gunman went in with a machine gun and killed, I think it's 49 people. And he was somebody who was able to escape while his friends died. I don't think I can even fathom how that can fuck with your head, you know, because you're going to say, why am I alive while my friends, many of my friends, are not? Because you ran out a door, because you exited the building. But he is an advocate for LGBTQ plus rights, and I love what he does. I love the way he tells stories, and I hope someday he becomes a senator. Wouldn't that be great? You know, having a senator like that for the state of Florida. Of course, we have elections coming up. If you are in a state that, unfortunately, your vote doesn't count. It does count, but you feel like it doesn't count. Like Illinois, California, New York. Or if you're on the other side of the fence, Wyoming, where you know it's going to go red. But particularly if you understand how phenomenally evil and vile Trump is. And this is one of the perks for me because Polaris is not a 501c3. The Phil Ferguson Show is not a 501c3. I can say whatever the fuck I want about politics. If you see Trump as a clear and present danger as I do, and if you are not in a state where your vote can really flip the Electoral College, find a way to help in one of those states. Go to those states. Talk to your local Democratic office. There is a distinct possibility that you might be able to drive people to polls to vote. You might be able to work phone banks. You might be able to donate money to local candidates. You gotta find a friend or find some of your friends that live in those states and remind them, not only must you vote, but you should tell 3 to 5 other people to vote. We really have to have a turnout. I really don't want this to be so close that it comes down to one or two states that then get challenged in the courts, and we have 4 or 5 or more months of arguments while Republicans and Trump try to destroy the integrity of our electoral process. So please get involved, do something, whatever you can. While I'm talking about doing something, I want to tell you that my wife and I have a new fundraising match, a new project that we're supporting. And that campaign is for the Central Florida Freethought community. You can find more about it at CFFC. What is this? Freethought. That's the website. You can look it up for Central Florida Freethought community. Once you get to the website, look for the link to the page Ferguson. You can also Google it. I just did it. Hopefully it didn't just show up for me because I've already done it before. But Central Florida Freethought Ferguson, centralfloridafreethought.org/Ferguson. We are encouraging people to make monthly donations to this group in Florida, which is our local group here in Florida, Central Florida area. It is doing wonderful things. Every other year, there's a conference, and then every other year, alternating with the conference, is a cruise. If you've never gone to one of those, look them up. In 2025, I think it's March 15th-ish, is the next convention in Central Florida. So if you want to come to Florida when there's beautiful weather, March, oh my God, absolutely divine. And you can come to the convention, meet regular friends, old friends, make new friends at the Central Florida Freethought Convention. They're allowing people to book passage on the cruise for 2026 already. My wife and I are booked for that. The speakers for that will be Andrew and Liz Seidel. They are attorneys for Americans United and the Freedom From Religion Foundation, respectively. I think that's the word to use there. So anyway, the match that we're doing for the Central Florida Freethought community is a doubling match, but it's based on how much money you donate per month. Just like a few months ago, we did this for the Secular Student Alliance. We want you to donate and go to that webpage I told you about, centralfloridafreethought.org/Ferguson or CFF. God, I can't read that. Hang on a second. I'm going to zoom in. Man, I knew I wasn't reading that eye, right? So here's the web address, CFL, Central Florida, Freethought, all one word, CFL, freethought.org/Ferguson. So if you donate $10 a month, we will match 12 months worth of that donation at the end of this year. So if you donate $10 a month, 12 months is $120. We will donate $120. We have done well, and we have done well with the secular community, and this is where my passion is, and it's where our money goes. And again, this is from me and my wife, up to $10,000. You do not need to live in Florida. You do not need to live in the United States. But if you want to make a difference and help secular, humanist, atheist individuals have a place to go, if you want to support an organization that gives away scholarships to secular students to help them get to college, it's all to try to fix on a grassroots level some of the problems that we have in the United States so that we can be seen and heard and have a place to go and not feel alone for some people, to feel loved for some people, to make a difference for other people. The organization does so much good, which is why we're willing to put up $10,000. And we want to encourage people to make monthly donations because it helps make their budget, at least their cash flow, more even so they can plan for things. Ideally, at some point, I'd love for there to be a building. We went to an organization in Denver that has a building. I was so jealous. But we want to have a building at some point. I do. That's Phil's goal. But in the meantime, the group organization does a lot of good. So if you can swing $10 a month, if you can do $50 a month, that's the upper limit of what we'll match. But if you can do $50 a month, 12 months worth is $600. So not only will they get the $600, but you're going to cost me and my wife another $600, and we're happy to pay it. But that's up to $10,000, and that ends at latest the end of this calendar year. But I don't want you to wait until December because you're going to get bombarded by everybody that wants your donation money. So it's October. Think about going there now. And again, it's CFL, Central Florida, CFL, freethought.org/Ferguson or Ferguson's. I think we have both pages linked to the same as a redirect. Go there and hit the little button that says donate now. Read all the details, learn about what they do. And again, you don't have to be in Florida. I mean, you can talk about how Florida sucks, and I'm with you there politically. This is your chance to fucking do something. It's not going to cost you a lot. Go give some money. If you have a whole bunch of money and you're not worried about the match, let's say you want to give $100,000 to them, let me know. I can put you in charge, in contact with the people that can do that. And because one of my next goals or desires for them is to set up a foundation so the organization can last in perpetuity in case anything happens to the current leaders, which are David and Jocelyn Williamson, who do amazing work. But we can't rely on them always doing the work. We need more people involved. We need it to be more formal. We need it to be bigger. And we need it to have money. Just think about how much money churches and these organizations that are doing Project 2025 have. I'm not asking you to give 10% of your income. 5 should do it. If you can give 5%, if everyone listening here gave 5% to a secular, humanist, atheistic organization, the amount of money that we would have to combat the bullshit in the United States of America would be staggering. Anyway, end rant. FFRF convention was fantastic, and you might hear in the following weeks and or episodes from many of the speakers that were there. If you couldn't make it, I'm going to find out. I know they recorded them. They have videos of all this. I think it's going to go online. I'll let you know where to go look once I know where that is. If you haven't been to a conference lately and you've got some time in middle, late October, the next thing I'm going to be at is the Center for Inquiries conference, which is called CSIcon. I'm sure if you Google those words in some kind of order, you're going to come up to it. I think they're still selling tickets. So go check that out. It's in Vegas. It's great fun. It's at the Horseshoe Casino. And I almost forgot to remind everybody, if you go to that event, or if you're just in the area or want to be in the area, and let me go on my calendar here to make sure I've got the right date. Thursday, October 24th at 3 p.m., we are going to go to a bar right in front of Horseshoe. And the name escapes me right now. I'll mention it later in the show or at the end of the show. And then after that, at 5 o'clock, we're going to go eat. And then around 7, we're going to go back to the convention and see the opening night fuel bar. There it is. See, I knew if I just went on. At 3 o'clock, we're going to go to the fuel bar. And like I said, in the closing comments, I'll have specific details. But that is October 24th. It might be 4 people that show up, and we'll have a great time. It might be 40 people, and we're going to have even a better time. So you don't have to be a client. This is friends of the show or friends of friends or anyone you know that's going to the conference or even anyone that's not going to the conference but can get to this part of Vegas. So if you want to drive in a couple of hours and hang with us for 4 hours, that would be absolutely fantastic. So October 24th at the beginning of CSIcon in the Horseshoe Casino, Las Vegas. We're going to meet outside of the Horseshoe Casino, really close to Las Vegas Boulevard and a place called the Fuel Bar. And then from 3 to 5 p.m. local time there. And then from 5 to 7, we will eat at Wahlburger. And all of this is, you're on your own financially. I am not buying drinks and food for 40 people. But I invite you to come and hang out with us and have some really good times. So whew, that's a lot about where I've traveled, where I've been in the last week or two, and where I'm going in late October. I do hope to see you there. And if you're there, if you see me or you hear my voice out in the hallway, you are invited by me to come up and say hello. I do look forward to that. I do get a great enjoyment out of that. So hopefully I will see you soon, and we'll go on with the more stuff of the show.
You're listening to The Bill Ferguson Show.
How you can justify wanting to take something away from people from 95 that gives meaning to 95% of the American people and replace it with something that gives meaning to just 5% of the American people?
Ah, well, what an incredibly stupid question. First, I've said repeatedly that this stuff cannot be taken away from people. It is their favorite toy, and it will remain so. As Freud said in The Future of an Illusion, it will remain that way as long as we're afraid of death and have no problem, which is, I think, likely to be quite a long time. Second, I hope I've made it clear that I'm perfectly happy for people to have these toys and to play with them at home and hug them to themselves and so on and share them with other people who come around and play with the toys. So that's absolutely fine. They are not to make me play with these toys. Okay? I will not play with the toys. Don't bring the toys to my house. Don't say, my children must play with these toys. Don't say, my toys might be a condom. Here we go again. Are not allowed by their toys. I'm not going to have any of that. Enough with clerical and religious bullying and intimidation. Is that finally clear? Have I got that across? Thank you.
The Phil Ferguson Show is for educational and entertainment purposes only. Nothing said on the show should be interpreted as personalized investment advice. Investments should be based on your personal situation, and you, of course, should consult with your financial advisor or tax professional before taking any actions. This is part 4 of the Polaris Plan 2024. We've already done parts 1 through 3. Obviously, that's why we're at part 4, and I think there will be in total 6 parts. So if you just happen to catch this show for whatever reason and not have listened to the previous 3 episodes with part 1, 2, and 3, you may want to go and start there. Show number 500. Yes, 500 plus shows. Absolutely amazing. I can't believe the show has lasted this long. And of course, thank you to everyone that listens. So we've had a discussion about how it works in general, how much of your money should be in bonds versus stocks. Then we talked about the specific bonds to use in part 3. And now this part 4, I'm going to look at stocks in a little more focus. We've done the bond / cushion stuff. And now the next thing to think about is how much to have in the U.S. stock market versus the international non-US part of your stocks. And this is specifically for people that live in the United States. So if you are in another country, this doesn't really apply to you. If you're in another country and plan to stay and live in that country, I would think that some generous portion of your money should be invested in your own domestic index fund, whether that's France, Germany, South Africa, Japan, whatever, but it would probably be a lower portion than I recommend for citizens in the United States. So if you're in France or Germany, for example, Italy, I would want my specific country, and then I would want to make sure that I have a chunk in Europe as a whole, and then maybe a chunk that's in the US, and then maybe other countries, just to broadly diversify. You just don't want to get a sudden big problem if your currency happens to do particularly well or badly against international stocks. So just that caveat for listeners outside of the United States. If you're in the United States, one thing that can happen is international can suddenly do well for many years, but it could also underperform the U.S. stock market. And in this case, for many years, that's where we currently are. Although that has changed a little, let me give you an example. The Vanguard Large Cap Growth Index Fund, Admiral Shares, has just been on fire for years. Of course, we've talked about, and we'll talk about more probably in the next segment or two, in 2022, it went down quite dramatically. And for the last 3 months, and this is from Morningstar, and this is the very beginning of October, end of September, for the last 3 months, the large cap growth index fund has made a 1.49% return in 3 months. The total international in the last 3 months is 8.27. So international has underperformed materially, maybe even dramatically on average for years. But now in the last 3 months, it's crushed the large cap growth. So things change. That's the thing that I want you to have in mind, that you can always look at all of the funds that I use and look backwards 1 year, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years. As a matter of fact, for clients, I can provide that and often do provide that. If you're a client and you haven't seen your version of the plan in a while, all you got to do is ask. I'll make a new one and send it to you and we can go over it. But you can always look at all the funds that I recommend and any given time period where the data is easily available, say, wow, this fund did the best over 3 years or 5 years or 10 years or 15 years. Why didn't we have more money there? Well, the big problem, of course, is you know that now, but you didn't know that 3, 5, or 10, or 15 years ago. So that's the piece of knowledge we didn't have in the past. So you it's fun to look at, it's neat to see, but you don't want to overdo it. And so being slightly contrarian and wanting to have broadly diversified portfolio, a generous portion of your stock or stock index funds should be in international. And the next episode, I'll go over those specific funds. Today, I want to focus on that fact that you want a generous portion. Right now, I am thinking 30 to 35% should be international, not 30 to 35% of your portfolio, but 30 to 35% of your stock investment. So if you have $1 million and you've decided that $300,000 should be in the cushion for whatever reason, see previous segments, that means you have $700,000 in stocks. Of that $700,000, 30%, 35%, if it's 30% of $700,000, that'd be $210,000 should be in international. And like I said, the next episode, I go over which specific funds that I use and the allocations. One of the things I look at is long-term trends, not short-term fluctuations. I'd like to think that I'm not market timing. I am doing market-based adjustments. Now, maybe that's a semantics thing and you don't see the difference. Okay, cool. But people who day trade or adjust too quickly or jump in and out, and we've talked about this many times, at least I have, to you. Thank you for listening to me ramble on, but you need to have a plan. One of the key things about the Polaris plan is that it is a plan. You don't have to follow exactly my plan. You might hear some of these ideas and find them useful in your situation. You might not. You want to have a plan because the plan that you're going to make lasts 1, 3, 5, 10 years, 20 years. You can adjust it from time to time, particularly as you approach retirement. But what you don't want to do is put yourself in a situation where you hear something, you see a show, a friend of yours tells you in the bar that this thing is a great opportunity. I don't do that. I don't want to do that. One of the reasons I don't like individual stocks is because, first of all, you have a thing called individual stock or specific stock risk, which means on the upside, that stock could go up 10 times. On the other hand, it could go to zero and you could lose 100% of the money you have in that individual stock. Having all these broadly diversified index funds virtually, if not completely, eliminates specific stock risk. So there are ways you can eliminate risk or at least dramatically reduce it. Another way to reduce risk, aka volatility, is to not have all of your stock index investing funds in the US. You have part of it in the international because you will have periods of time. As an example, the last 3 months, large cap growth in the US has been crushing it year after year, with the exception of 22. But in the last 3 months, it's made next to nothing, while international has made 8.5%. So for all those people who I've talked to, clients, in particularly in the last few months, in the last year or two, Phil, why do you have so much in international? It's lagging. What ain't lagging right now? Now, that might change tomorrow, but that trend might continue for years. And if you have read the books that I recommend, when you get to the fourth book, Common Sense on Mutual Funds by John Bogle, there's a generous section that shows you that there are large periods of time, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, where international stocks, at least from the perspective of a U.S. citizen, outperform dramatically domestic stocks. When is that going to happen? Who the fuck knows? See, so I think admitting that I don't know the future and that I have no idea what's going to happen next, and embracing that creates maybe, I don't know, an evergreen plan. So when international stocks suddenly do better, like they have for the last 3 months, you're already there. It may look like that your overall performance for 1 year, 3 year, 5 year, or 10 year looks smaller, and probably does, if you had just been in the US. But that can change, and often by the time you know that it changed, now it's too late and you missed a sudden surprise in another part of the stock investing world. So that's why I want to have all of those things. So right now, international should be 30, maybe 35% of your total stock investment funds, index funds. And we're going to go over the list of funds that I use next episode. So that's this section. Oh, I almost forgot. I did want to include this. This also goes in line with the clarity, granularity tag team idea that I love so much, because you can often buy broadly diversified managed funds, managed stock funds. Of course, not only are the expense ratios higher than index funds, but often the trading activity is dramatically higher, and therefore you pay more taxes every year, particularly if you're in a taxable account. That can whittle away at your compounding returns quite dramatically in the long run. So we want to keep all of that as low as possible. But if you have a broadly diversified stock fund, or often in the industry, they call it a global fund, which means it includes your home country and the whole planet. Usually international means everything but the US. Global means everything, including the US. Although there's no regulatory or legal requirements that the fund name in that convention. It's just common that they do. So if you have a fund that invests in domestic US or and international stock, it might have 10% in international at one moment in time, and it might have 50% in international at a different moment in time. So it's hard for you to know exactly what portion of your portfolio is international. So you lack that clarity. The nice thing about knowing what you have and then having funds that do different things during different periods of time is that if you are adding money, you can add to the laggards. If you are removing money, you can take money out of the things that have done the best. If you are doing a readjustment or a rebalancing, you take money from the things that have done the best and maybe add it to the things that have not done the best. I hate to say the worst, but the lowest performers. And that rebalancing, that adding money, removing money, when you have more clarity, and of course the granularity where you can reduce your exposure to international and make it more US, or you could reduce your exposure to international small cap and add to US large cap. The only way you can have any input on that in an informed manner is if you know exactly what your funds are in. And that is one of the reasons I love the Vanguard index funds. Because if you have a Vanguard international small cap fund, virtually all of the money is in international small cap stocks. So you can look at the total dollar value you have in domestic small cap and international small cap and see exactly what the difference is between the two, and you can make an adjustment. So that's some of the logic of why I do what I do. And I think I'm repeating myself now. So this is part four of the Polaris Plan 2024. And hopefully next episode, we'll have 5 and 6. And of course, if you have any questions, or if I've made it more confusing and not less confusing, you may email me, phil@polarisfinancialplanning.com, and I would be happy to answer an email or talk to you about it.
Reverend Mesa, Reverend Rock,
I'm grateful for your generous invitation to state my views. While the so-called religious issue is necessarily and properly the chief topic here tonight, I want to emphasize from the outset that I believe that we have far more critical issues in the 1960 campaign. The spread of communist influence until it now festers only 90 miles from the coast of Florida. The humiliating treatment of our president and vice president by those who no longer respect our power. The hungry children I saw in West Virginia. The old people who cannot pay their doctor's bills. The families forced to give up their farms, and America with too many slums, with too few schools, and too late to the moon and outer space. These are the real issues which should decide this campaign. And they are not religious issues for war and hunger and ignorance and despair. No, no religious barrier. But because I am a Catholic, and no Catholic has ever been elected president, the real issues in this campaign have been obscured, perhaps deliberately, in some quarters less responsible than this. So it is apparently necessary for me to state once again, not what kind of church I believe in, for that should be important only to me, but what kind of America I believe in. I believe in an America where the separation of church and state is absolute, where no Catholic prelate would tell the president, should he be Catholic, how to act, and no Protestant minister would tell his parishioners for whom to vote. When no church or church school is granted any public funds or political preference, and when no man is denied public office merely because his religion differs from the president who might appoint him or the people who might elect him. I believe in an America that is officially neither Catholic, Protestant, nor Jewish, when no public official either requests or accepts instructions on public policy from the Pope, the National Council of Churches, or any other ecclesiastical source, when no religious body seeks to impose its will, directly or indirectly, upon the general populace or the public acts of its officials, and where religious liberty is so indivisible that an act against one church is treated as an act against all. For while this year it may be a Catholic against whom the finger of suspicion is pointed, in other years it has been, and may someday be again, a Jew, or a Quaker, or a Unitarian, or a Baptist. It was Virginia's harassment of Baptist preachers, for example, that led to Jefferson's statute of religious freedom. Today I may be the victim, but tomorrow it may be you. Until the whole fabric of our harmonious society is ripped apart at a time of great national peril. Finally, I believe in an America where religious intolerance will someday end, where all men and all churches are treated as equals, where every man has the same right to attend or not to attend the church of his choice, where there is no Catholic vote, no anti-Catholic vote, no block voting of any kind, and where Catholics, Protestants, and Jews, at both the lay and the pastoral levels, will refrain from those attitudes of disdain and division, which have so often marred their works in the past, and promote instead the American ideal of brotherhood. That is the kind of America in which I believe.
You're listening to The Phil Ferguson Show.
All right, everybody. With me, I have the authors of a brand new book. Let's see here. I'm on Amazon. Goodbye Religion, The Causes and Consequences of Secularization.
Yep.
And that is Ryan Cragun. Say hi, Ryan, so everybody can see who you are.
Hello, everyone.
And he has been on the show before, and a new guest to the show, Jesse Smith.
Right here. Hello.
Yeah. Now, for those listening to the podcast, this interview is also going to be available as a video, so you can go to YouTube and check it out. So if I say we're looking at this person or that person, I apologize to the audio listeners. It may not make sense, but that's why. If you're listening to the podcast, I don't think you're going to miss anything out other than seeing the three of us in full color glory talking. And of course, I have a lot to learn about Zoom and Zoom recording, so please forgive me in advance if it's shitty. Anywho, this book, as of the moment we're recording, is not technically out, but I was able to buy a copy from the Freedom From Religion Foundation conference, and it comes out only days after this recording, and people can pre-order. Is that correct?
Yep, that's correct. It comes out October 8th. Is that right, Jesse?
That's right. Yep.
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 So,
and I'm looking at the Amazon page, and it says pre-order, price guaranteed. And on October 8th, I don't know if they send it on October 8th or if it lands on your doorstep on October 8th.
I think it should land on the doorstep.
I'm hoping. So now I'm assuming you guys planned this. This is being delivered just in time for Christmas.
I don't know that that was the plan.
Well,
but hey, you know, if it works, great. Yeah, it'd make a great Christmas gift.
I like to think it is. And I don't know if Ryan knew this and Jesse wouldn't know this. One of the themes I've had over the years is encouraging people and children out of religion. Now, I'm assuming you guys aren't necessarily taking a position of advocacy one way or the other. You're researching the data and trying to explain it to us. So before I ask questions about the book that I just half read, half skimmed, my apologies, time crunch, is there anything particular you'd like to bring up about the book or other works? Just feel free to jump in.
Well, you know, I'll say that I was thinking about this just before we got on here. You know, Ryan approached me about this. The idea for the book was his, really. He approached me at a conference a few years back. And it struck us that we both had something interesting here to contribute to a book that would kind of be, we wanted this to sort of be, you know, the book on religious exiting in the U.S. I've done a lot of interviews throughout my career and have, you know, expertise in qualitative research methods. Ryan's done a lot of quantitative work, and we just thought, you know, this is a good opportunity to do a solid mixed methods project on the ins and outs of why people are leaving religion. And so that's kind of where the idea was born. I think this was probably, that was a while ago, 2018, 19, yeah. Ryan, something like that.
Yeah.
So it was several years in the making, and we thought that it would be interesting. It was a nice way of kind of capping off a lot of research that we've done over, you know, really a couple of decades here, and that it would be of interest. You know, there's a lot of important changes that have happened even in the time that we sort of conceived of the book. So we were excited to put it together, and hopefully people get some use out of it.
How about you, Ryan? You want to throw in anything before I have some comments?
You know, I think Jesse really hit it. We've been working on this for a long time. I do like to mention that my doctoral dissertation in 2007 was on people leaving religion. And this book is way better than that.
Well, I think in the book, it even said you were wrong, basically.
Yes, that, I was.
Okay.
Right. So
hopefully I remember that.
Somebody was reading the book pretty closely, right? You know, Jesse and I have both been working in this area for a very long time. And like I mentioned, my dissertation was on this, but I've learned a ton, right? Like the beauty of being an academic, a professor, and doing research is like, I'm always learning. I love that I just could continuously get to be learning. And this book is the culmination of, you know, over 20 years of working in this area and kind of hopefully, you know, being right at the cutting edge of the discipline. So yeah, it's a great collaboration. We had a good time doing this.
Before we get into some of the details, I want the listeners to know, you know, spoilers. First of all, we're going to talk about what's in the book. Again, the book is titled Goodbye Religion, : The Causes and Consequences of Secularization. It is a, I think, a wonderful blend of what Jesse mentioned, qualitative and quantitative analysis, data and statistics from surveys, research studies, you know, where people get to pick numbers and you can run calculations on them. But it also has a lot, several hundred, several thousand interviews and snippets and sound bites from people expressing their nuanced opinions about where they came from, how they got there, where they're going. So it's a, I think it was Jesse that said it. This is, or maybe it was Ryan. This is now the most thorough, complete work on the subject. And again, from qualitative and quantitative. And one of the things that I really liked was early in the book, the discussion of who's leaving religion. Mm-hmm. And maybe the stereotypes were true 20 years ago, but maybe they're not now. What were the stereotypes and why are they less reliable today?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. I'll jump in if that's okay, Jesse, and then mm-hmm. you can fill in some details. So if we go back to like the 1970s and 80s, there were some people who had left religion, and there was some early research. Probably the earliest research is from the late 1960s. There's very little before that, really. And most of that research was basically focused on young white men, particularly well-to-do, highly educated men, were like the most likely to leave. And so that's where, it all got framed as like risk factors back then, right? Because leaving religion was a bad thing. So it was like, oh, these are the people at risk for leaving. And that was kind of true, right? They were statistically slightly more likely to leave religion, but it's not like they were the only ones, right? So even if we go back then, it was like a 60-40 split between men and women in terms of who was leaving religion. So it's still 40% of the people who were leaving religion were women. Why we turned that into, oh, you know, it's mostly, you know, white men, that wasn't true. Same with race, right? If you look back and look at race, it was always a sizable percentage of people who were leaving were black or other races, right? So it was never just white men. It was never just highly educated white men. That is a bit of a stereotype for like atheists, and there's some truth to that still, but it was never as big as we think. And those gaps have shrunk over time to where today, particularly like the gender gap, it's almost at parity. It's almost 50-50, which is pretty interesting. The age gap has shrunk. The educational gap has shrunk. So all of those have basically shrunk to where today, I think Jesse's the one who wrote this. It's like everybody's leaving religion, right? Now, we don't mean everybody, but we mean like it could be anybody is the idea. Demographics just doesn't do a really good job of predicting who's leaving anymore. What did I miss, Jesse?
No, that's right. Just on down the line, all of those different variables. I think it's just an assumption that was just kind of baked into, you know, the way that Americans think about this issue. It is technically true, right? Statistically true that there is a slight difference there, right? So there is, we've got some language in the book about that, but I think people have just made way too much of that. And those, again, all of those gaps continue to shrink. It's just not, we can't predict very well at all who's going to leave religion based on, you know, sociodemographic characteristics alone.
Because I know when I first started getting involved in the secular movement myself, maybe 20 plus years ago, I was the young white guy compared to the old white guys. And a lot of people in the organizations felt like they couldn't join an outspoken atheistic organization until they retired because they were so concerned that they would lose customers or clients. And, you know, if you have a normal business with a 5-10% margin and you lose 10 or 15% of your customers, you're done. You're toast. Yeah. You're cooked, as the kids say nowadays. You're cooked.
And of course, that's part of what's happening here too. I think you're right. The negative connotations, the social stigma, the context has changed, right? So that's sort of given a boost to the rise of those that are leaving religion, just because there's a context now where it's more plausible to do that.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I was focusing not only on people that left, but people that were obnoxious. Vocal about the fact that they had left. Whereas today in 2024, if I just look up YouTube videos, It's men, it's women, it's white, it's black, it's Hispanic, it's every kind of person, LGBTQ mm-hmm. people that are coming out, and either their fear is less than mine was, or they're doing it smarter, or they can so quickly start making money with it. Wow, what a change that you could make money with, you know, being an outspoken advocate. So that's absolutely fantastic. After the initial discussion in the book, I think it was 9 things that can kind of predict who might leave. Was it 9 things? Do I recall that correctly?
Probably the propositions.
Yes. Yeah. The propositions. Yeah. Can either one or both of you go over some of those, and how reliable are they, or how important are they?
Sure. I'm going to try and pull them up in the book. We actually have a list of all of them right at the back of the book. So maybe I'll just grab those and we can go through
them. It's so funny because as I was reading, I'm like, oh, I wish they had started with the list at the beginning and then gone through the 9 and then had the list. And since mine is a PDF in progress.
Yeah. It's towards the end. So I kind of apologize, but like, where we're laying them out, we have to build up an argument.
I understand.
Like, yeah. So we had to build up an argument to then give, and here's why we're going to give the proposition. But at the end, we did want to recap them for everybody, so everybody could see them just like straight in a list, so they knew exactly what we were doing. This is, a little bit weird for maybe a lay audience that we're getting formal theoretical propositions, but that's a big part of what we do as academics. Yeah. We're trying to lay out these propositions, one, because we have evidence to support them, but two, this makes it so other people, other scholars can then go, well, there's a formal proposition. I can go test that, right? So we're really trying to advance the field by laying these out and formalizing propositions that make it so people can test them. So happy to go through those. I did pull up the list.
Grab a couple.
So using our pretentious Latin, because, you know, we have to do that as scholars, but I'll just say what it means. So we start most of these with ceteris paribus, which means all else being equal, right? So we're scholars. We have to do the Latin. The very first one is individuals who hold more modern egalitarian views will be more likely to leave religion than those who hold more traditional views. Jesse, you want to jump in and explain what we mean by that one?
Well, yeah. And in some ways, these are just descriptions, right, of the evidence that we're proposing here. So I like Ryan's point about, like, these are propositions that can be tested, right? They might not all work exactly as we think that they are. These are not absolute statements of truth, right? So they can be tested. But yeah, this comes from both the survey data and the interview data. Those people that tend to accept certain, modern explanations, really, and scientific explanations, for instance, the origin of the cosmos, human evolution, the age of the earth, you know, those kinds of things are statistically much more likely to exit religion than those who hold views that don't, embrace those kind of modern sort of findings. We use the word modern very, very broadly. Yeah. That can mean a lot of different things in different contexts. That one in particular, and that's our first one, Ryan.
That's the very first one, yeah.
Yeah. It's just a kind of a very generic, general propositional statement saying that, you shouldn't be surprised if those that accept the, very kind of basic modern statements about the nature of reality are more likely to exit religion. It's pretty much that simple.
And it's not any kind of double blind kind of tested thing. It's something that's been teased out of the data, and it looks like it's clear, strong, and compelling. So there's probably no specific P value that you've assigned to it. You're making the proposition based on what you've seen. And like you said, I didn't pick that up in the book, so I'm thankful that you explained it to me. It's now something somebody else can grab, any one of these 9, and try to find a more formal testing mechanism or, another bit of research that supports or disproves the proposition.
And it's another reason that we left it sort of toward the end of the book, listing them out, because they mirror back what the data is showing as we build this argument throughout.
Yeah, I liked it. Ryan, you want to grab another one?
Sure. So we'll do number two. We probably shouldn't do all nine, but
I wasn't going to do all nine.
Two. Okay,
get boring.
That'd be the whole podcast.
Yeah, and they need to buy the book. So
yeah, there you go. I appreciate the promotion. That's good. That's good. So let's do number two, and then we can maybe skip down, and I'll pick a different one. But so all else being equal, ceteris paribus, individuals who have more progressive social and political values will be more likely to leave religion than will individuals who have more conservative social and political values. Think that one's pretty clear on the face of it, right? Basically, people who are leaning to the left are more likely to leave religion. Now, admittedly, and Jesse can fill in some of the details here, we go into a lot of depth on this particular topic because of some prior research and proposals that have been put out there that we take issue with a number of other proposals, but we really go deep into this one. Jesse, did you want to add on that?
Well, I think it's probably worth mentioning the Houghton Fisher argument about the kind of the stepping stone thing away from religion. What is motivating people to exit religion, right? On the especially the influence of the religious right. Why don't you give us a brief walkthrough of that?
Yeah, so there's an article from the early 2000s, I think it's 2001, by Houghton Fisher, where they basically made this claim that the alignment of the religious right with the Republican Party, right? So, and we're not trying to be political here. So we're trying to be apolitical, right? We're just describing
just the
literature.
Data. Just the data.
Yeah, it's just the data, right? So they make the argument that the alignment of the religious right with conservatives has actually led a whole bunch of people who don't agree politically, right? So they disagree with the conservative positions politically, that they're like, oh, well, if my religion is going to associate with conservative politics, I'm going to leave religion. And we argue that it's at a minimum missing a step, right?
Yeah.
Because and maybe we're being too generous to people, like maybe people do leave for those reasons. But in our minds, we're like, wait, if I really value religion and my particular religion just becomes more conservative, why would I give up all religion? Why wouldn't I just go to a different religion, right?
Yeah.
And so, yeah, more progressive religion. And that's not what Houghton Fisher argued. They argued like, no, this is why people are leaving religion. And we're just like, no, that doesn't make any sense. So this is why we spend quite a bit of time like filling in details saying, well, maybe it could start a pathway out of religion, but it just doesn't make sense for it to immediately be like, oh, you know, my religion is now conservative, Republican, or whatever. I'm out. I'm giving up all religion. Like, it just didn't make sense to us. So we do unpack that quite a bit and spend a lot of time on that.
I would.
Go ahead.
No, I was just thinking out loud here. Can't it be both?
You
know,
it could.
You know, maybe there's two big categories there, because I know a lot of people. Once someone changes from one religion to another, from my perspective, they're now more likely to eventually become an atheist. I don't know if there's data for that, but I think I've seen it. But I also have met a lot of people who were really into their church and really, when politics got in and they had problems with the politics, they started having problems with the politics. Then they started having problems with religion. And sometimes the most conservative religions, you don't wander your way out. You break. And when you leave Jehovah's Witnesses, when you leave Mormonism, you often don't go somewhere else because it was, you were so deep that you have to snap out. But
yeah, no, I think you're right. I think it definitely can be both. The question is, what's the general pattern if there is one? This actually links up to our conclusion. We deal with this a lot, as Ryan said, right? When people, you know, if those that sort of do go to more progressive religions, right? That's something that more aligns with our political and social values and beliefs, et cetera. We kind of argue that that context isn't radically different from just the secular society at large, right? So there might not be a lot of reason or motivation to stay with a particular progressive religion, right? They're already part of, it's already sort of consistent with broader secular values. And
right.
So that might kind of be a bit of a halfway house before becoming fully, secular. We can, that's kind of how we end part of our conclusion there. So we can loop back to that. But I think you're right. It can be both things.
It could certainly be both. Yeah.
All right, Ryan, pick a third one of your choice. Cause like you said, you don't want to ruin the whole video, the whole audio.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have a lot of we have a lot of typologies and lots of things going on here.
So there is a lot. All right, let's jump all the way to the end, right? So maybe then we can turn to something else. Is that okay?
Yes,
please. Yeah, we go right to the end. So I actually really like this one. Proposition 9. It doesn't actually start with ceteris paribus. This is kind of a fun one. The larger the proportion of someone's social network that is non-religious, the higher the odds they will leave religion. And that one I think we end up talking about in a slightly different chapter. I think that comes up not in chapter 3, but like chapter 5 or something like that. This, it's an under-researched area from my perspective on kind of the influence of social networks and people leaving religion. There's a little bit of research on this. I was involved in a simulation study, actually. So it was computer simulations where we were kind of modeling this. But the basic idea is that for a lot of people... we're going to go a little bit on a tangent. A lot of people like to say, I left religion because I thought my way out of it, right? Mm-hmm. And that's probably true for some people, but it's also a story we tell to make us look better, right? It's like, I'm so smart. I figured it out and everybody else is wrong. But I think reality is actually much muddier than that and more complicated. And I think for a lot of people, it's, you know what? I saw somebody who's not religious and it gave me this idea of like, oh, that's a possibility. And then my social network shift because maybe I moved or I got a new job or I, you know, whatever it was. And in that shift, maybe I moved away from some of my really religious friends and I got some friends who weren't as religious or maybe not religious at all. And so the shifting social network can actually be much more influential than I think we realize. It doesn't necessarily bubble up into our consciousness that they're actually influencing us. But in fact, there's a lot of really good research to suggest that our social network is a very strong influence on the things that we do. And so all we're arguing is if you actually get a more dense social network that's connected to people who are not religious, that's going to dramatically increase the odds that you're going to leave as well.
What do you got, Jesse?
Yeah. No, I mean, we deal with both, I think, in the book, right? So we don't want to downplay, because a lot of scholars will tend to downplay the cognitive intellectual dimension, right? It's not really about beliefs, right? It's about anything other than what people actually believe, right? And the claims that religions make and people's cognitive assent to those claims or not, right? But we actually write that, you know, beliefs matter, right? They matter a great deal, right? It's important, but it is just half of the story, right? We're sociologists, and so we're by and large taking a social and psychological kind of approach to things, but we're largely explaining things in terms of external social forces, right, and processes. And so, you know, that's what we're focused on, and social networks is one of those kind of external forces, right? It matters the context in which a person is living their lives, right? And if you've got, as Ryan said, even just one friend, right, that's not religious or has left religion, right? And you look at their life and it's not a disaster and they seem like a normal person. It kind of opens up this space, this realization, right? So there's an emotional and social component to this as well. It's not merely people sitting there, you know, engaging in their powers of reasoning and reasoning their way out of, you know, religious dogmas and claims and things like that.
Because I am fascinated myself with the idea of how and why people leave religion. And so when I meet people that have left religion, I always want to hear their stories. And there's some common themes, but they're almost always different. So it's fascinating. And I don't know if either one of you would want to speak on this subject, but what could we as individuals or society do to help nudge people out? Are you willing to go there?
To nudge people out of religion?
Yeah. And what can we set up?
I have to say for myself, Ryan gets to say whatever he wants to say about this. To me, it's not an advocacy book for me. I really don't. I'm not interested in, you know, making people non-religious, right? That we really do just try to, you know, describe the data and the importance of, you know, what are the consequences of this undeniable shift, right? The religious and the non-religious alike all recognize that more and more people are leaving religion.
Indeed.
And we'll have a lot of concerns about this. I'm not a, you know, I don't really advocate. I don't need people to be atheists, for instance, right? It's not a an end point or,
Right.
or an answer to anything. To me, it's just a lack of any particular belief in any particular God. So Ryan might have something a little bit
Ryan,
different to say here about this. He might have a more of an advocacy disposition.
Yeah.
But that anyway, that's me.
Yeah, fair enough.
Yeah. I mean, certainly the way that we frame the book is it's not an advocacy book, right? It's a scholarly book, and that's the idea. So it's very much meant to be just like, this is what we found. This is the reality of it. I'll give kind of a weird lead up to what I'm going to say. As an academic, right, like I try and just be scholarly to the extent that I can and objective that to the extent I can. But occasionally I do get asked to take these positions. I was actually invited about a year ago to go speak to a bunch of researchers at the headquarters of the LDS Church, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And they wanted me to give the opposite perspective. How can we stop people
yeah.
from leaving religion, right? And which is weird, right? I mean, for people who know me personally, which I'm not going to get into my personal stuff, but like that's a weird position for me to take. But if you're just asking it from an academic standpoint, I think then I can kind of don that hat and say, all right, well, from a surely academic standpoint, are there things that we could do that would actually lead down that path? So I did that for the LDS Church. Like, given your question, let's just put on that hat, right? And say, yeah. well, if that's what you are interested in, based on the research that I have seen and that I've done, are there specific things that we could actually do? The first thing that I'd say, and this is going to run counter to, I think, what a lot of people think about when they're like, ooh, you know, doing this. If you attack religious people, their natural response is to defend. So attacking is actually not particularly effective at getting people to leave religion. If you think about it, right, like we've probably all been in those situations where we're talking to somebody who we disagree with politically, maybe religiously. And if they attack us, right, it's the rare person who's like, you know, I'm not going to defend any of my beliefs. I'm just going to listen to you and like
right.
wait to get your good points here. Right. And I just won't defend anything. Right. It's really hard as humans to just be like, yeah, you just have great points and I have nothing to respond to that. So the idea that we could be hypercritical of somebody who's religious when we meet them and just be like, well, here, this is wrong and that's not true. And like, if you do that, they're just going to defend. So from my perspective, a far more effective way to actually, again, donning that hat, right? If I were trying to get people to be like, hey, that's a possibility, I would be a really good person, right? Set a great example for them, illustrate to them that I can live a perfectly healthy, happy, normal life without religion. And what that's going to do is basically plant these seeds of like, oh, wow, right? Like this person is perfectly right. fine and they're not religious. And that in and of itself, I think is going to do most of the work is just being a decent human being instead of constantly berating them, fighting, attacking. That's just going to make them defend. And the more they defend, the stronger their beliefs are actually going to be. So
well, just like,
again, donning that hat, I think it would,
yeah,
that
yeah,
would be probably the best
way to approach point. It. Nine, you know, the more secular or more worldly your network is, that might suggest if an atheist had an agenda like I do, that maybe one of your goals would be to join more groups where it has nothing to do with atheism whatsoever.
Yep.
Make a whole bunch of new friends so that if you make 5 or 10 new friends, each of those 5 or 10 people now have one more atheist in yep. their bubble. Even if you never talk about religion, that might just be, you know, a little tweak mm-hmm. on the knob. We can do more thoughts if you really want to, but I also want to try to get through more of the book.
Sure.
Because I don't want to take 2 hours, although I think
well, I just wanted to throw in there, too. None of this is to say that it's not enjoyable to watch a good debate. Right?
Yeah.
I
mean, yeah. Yeah.
I like the argumentation. I like the debate. There's a place for that, right? It's just yeah. not necessarily what we're up to in the book. And part of our introduction, actually, we kind of juxtapose these two viewpoints, like, here's what religious leaders and what the religious might say or think about what religious exiting is going to mean. And then on the other side of this, here's what non-religious people might say about this. Ryan alluded to this already with the idea that, you know, they reasoned their way out of it. They just, you know, they're very smart and so had to leave, right? It's like, I think the way we phrase it is about, it's like looking in a funhouse mirror, right? There's like these opposite explanations yeah. for why they left, right?
Yeah.
And our point in the book really is that they're both, you know, sort of wrong. It's really something in the middle that best explains what's happening.
Because I'm going to skip by a whole section, but I'm going to mention it to the viewer
sure.
and or listener. There's the whole section on people getting pushed out mm-hmm. of religion and people being pulled out of religion. And so to get all that, go buy the book. And then we get into the section that I thought was interesting is what people identify after they've left religion. And it's been a struggle for a lot of organizations that I've been in where people say everyone should identify as an atheist. A lot of people identify as a humanist, a secular humanist, a free thinker, a skeptic. The moniker that I most often use, and I'm being intentionally provocative. If people ask me, I will tell them that I am an evangelical atheist. You did not have that in your book, so I was not included.
Yes.
Sorry.
You can't represent
him. Yeah, that's okay. Thoughts on that subject with naming conventions and identity?
Well, let me start, and then I'll have Ryan jump in here, because part of this is a function of the data, right? And the kinds of data that we use, yeah. For instance, a lot of the qualitative data, and we were careful not to, you know, not all of our interviewees are people that join secular groups. We have a whole section on secular joiners and non-joiners, right? But many of them are. That was part of the way that I recruited many of the interviewees. And so they've thought a lot about this, right? They care about this issue. Even if they're not regularly involved in secular groups, they think a lot about their identity. Right. And, you know, you'll get stories about people, you know, sort of strategically using different identities depending on who they're with. Right. They don't hold any particular belief in any God. Right. They're a technical functional atheist. Right. But they'll use the word agnostic because it seems a little softer. A lot of people after they've come out, you know, and this can take time, sometimes years, decades, even they'll sort of, even if they don't call it this, they develop what is clearly, to Ryan and I, a humanistic worldview, right? A secular and humanistic worldview. They're naturalists. They're skeptics, right? There aren't supernatural components or agents in, that are part of their worldview. So even if they don't call themselves humanists, and many of them do, right? Many people don't really know or understand what humanism is to begin with,
yeah.
right? So
yeah.
they're sort of functionally they're humanists, even if they don't label. But we, you know, we've got stories of people really grappling with their identities and moving through different kinds of trajectories where there's a space in their life where, you know, how do I identify is critically important to them. And then later on down the road, it's like, I don't really care. It doesn't really matter that much, right? What my identity is. That's for those that really kind of, you know, deal with this, that had kind of the harder exit out of religion that you alluded to a little bit
right.
Earlier. Right. But for many of the more, you know, kind of the nominally religious, those that never were invested or really committed in any deep way in the first place, it's very different. They may just not even care or think about it. So maybe Ryan could say something about the indifference, right? The religiously indifferent.
Yeah. I was going to mention that. So the salience, that's the term that we kind of use for this, like how important is that identity for you? That varies a lot. And this is going to sound weird, but it's true, right? Like this is what the data say. The vast majority of people who leave religion don't then turn around and like, must destroy religion, right? They're like, I'm just going to live my life. I'm going to go fishing. I'm going to go to the, you know, the football game. I'm going to do whatever. That religion just becomes unimportant to them. So we often will refer to them as the religiously indifferent. And we don't mean that as though like you couldn't have a conversation with them and they might have opinions about religion. It's just that they're not actively engaged with anything to do with religion or non-religion or irreligion or atheism or activism. They just want to live their lives. They want to move on. So for some people, it is a very salient component, right? And these are the people who would go to an FFRF conference, right? Like
right.
It matters a lot to them. They see religion as a problem in society and they're going to fight that. So that would be high salience for this non-religious identity. But the vast majority of people who leave are the ones that Jesse was just talking about. There's like, you know, they kind of had a step in and now they have a step out and it just doesn't matter and they just want to live their lives. So we would say they have really low identity salience for this. They have lots of other identities. I mean,
right.
This is one of the points that we make in the book is like they do believe things. They just don't care about religion and they just don't want to live their lives worried about it. They're just going to move on.
Absolutely. And I don't know that I want to spend time on it unless either one of you want to jump in because we're getting long enough that I I want to wrap up at some point, but there's a whole section on death. And what does that mean? And we can leave it as a teaser for the viewer slash listener, or you could address it briefly. But I also want to throw out, you know, is there anything related, even if it's not in the book, that either one of you want to address or bring up or discuss before we wrap things up?
Well, on the death thing, I think we deal with some of that in chapter five, talking about the worldviews, you know, the belief systems that that religious exeters develop post religion, right? So yeah. There's a lot of questions left hanging in the air for some people after they've left a religion where there's sort of a pre, you know, determined canned answer about, I don't mean that in a pejorative way. There's just, there's a set of answers, you know, about the afterlife and about all the rest of it, right? And so some grapple with this, right? They know that they don't believe in any of this, you know, specific supernaturalist claims that the religion makes, right? But what, you know, what do they believe? And one of those issues is death, right? What happens after death? So people talking about the afterlife and what comes out of the qualitative data anyway. We might get a little bit different picture if we look at the survey research, but most of them tend to be just not adamantly like there's not an afterlife. I know that's the case, right? Not being a theist means not believing in an afterlife, which doesn't, you know, necessarily follow through. But they just they remain just kind of agnostic on those kinds of questions, right? But the bigger lesson that we draw is that it doesn't deprive them of meaning or importance in their lives, right? Like, so now I no longer believe this. So, you know, what's the point of it all? That's really just a false assumption that many people have, right? They are is absolutely intrigued by the mysteries of the universe, and they think about the cosmos and their smallness in it and their relationship to it, right? They grapple deeply with all of these questions, right? And I don't know that we actually had anyone that said like, and I know there's not, you know, an afterlife. They're just sort of like, many of them, again, by default, suggest that they don't, right? They don't expect there to be.
Right.
Right. They think consciousness probably ceases with the death of the body and brain, but they don't make definitive positive claims about this at all. That's on the death part. Ryan, is there something you wanted to add to either that or?
I think we're good on that. If we're wrapping up, I want to drop a couple of teasers about the book because there are some really fun things in there.
Sure.
Are we at that point?
That's good. Yeah.
Yeah. So we have a really fun discussion about what people do with their time when they're not involved with religion. And I'm probably going to leave it at that, but there's a little bit in there that actually has to do with sex and sexuality too, which it's just a teaser. Yeah, it's a teaser for the listeners, right? And that really is a very small piece. And then the last one that Phil got to see at the conference, I did present on chapter 6, which is The Consequences for Society.
Yes.
So if you remember the title of the book, it's The Causes and Consequences of Secularization. So we have a whole chapter that's like, hey, what are the consequences if more and more people are becoming non-religious? And we tackle that with really robust qualitative and quantitative data. And it's loads of fun. I think that, I mean,
was it
I think the book's a lot of fun.
Yeah, was it 10 consequences?
Yep. So yes. There are 10 questions that we address.
10 concerns. I suspect that most people will be most interested in that final chapter. It starts, you know, with things like, will people donate less to charity?
Right.
You know,
will they be less moral? Will they have fewer kids?
Right. Yeah. So loads of fun questions. And the great thing is we have data to answer all of them, right? Yeah. So we now have answers for this, which I think are a lot of fun.
Because
so
I know
a couple of teasers there.
I found, and I think a lot of other watchers and listeners will find, I would read a section and go, okay, that pretty much does it. What else could there be to talk about? Oh, wait, this looks good too. So it was a lot of that. It's not a Harry Potter novel where you've got to not put it down, but a lot of great information. Both of you did a bang up job writing it. The combination of qualitative and quantitative was superb. A generous but not overwhelming tables, charts, graphs. I like those more than most people. So you probably had internal debates between the two of you about how many of those to include. I would have wanted more, but that probably means you did the right amount. if you left me.
It is a longish book. It's a little bit longer than many that come from this press. There is a lot of data. So people that like data, they'll like it. But we also, again, we tried to write this for a broader audience than just other academics that are interested in this question. I think there's something in there for everyone. And I think people enjoy it.
And like I said at the beginning, just in time for Christmas, everybody, you can go order it at any quality bookstore. The name Goodbye Religion, The Causes and Consequences of Secularization. If you have anything else to throw in last minute, I welcome it. Or you can give information on how people can reach you, maybe to have you present at their church or at their secular conference, whatever either one of you want to do.
Jesse, you want to give your contact information?
Yeah, I think, let's see. Well, I'll just give my website. That's jessemacksmith.com, J-E-S-S-E. It's currently under construction. I'm trying to improve my website a little bit.
Ryan's
got his stuff together a little better on that question. I'm not on social media. And people can find my email and contact info on my website. They can visit my department homepage too at Western Michigan University.
Yeah, and I you can Google me, so I'm pretty easy, but I do have a website as well, RyanTCragun.com. But if you Google me, there is another Ryan Cragun out there. He played football for UCLA, and we compete for the top spot in Google results, right? I think I'm winning right now, but hey, you know, a UCLA football player, that's tough competition, but so I usually come out right on top.
So you're trying to convince me that you didn't play football?
I unfortunately did not.
Neither of us played football, to everyone's surprise.
Yeah.
I'm shocked, I tell you. Well, gentlemen, thank you both for writing a book that I thoroughly enjoyed, and of course, spending your time here for my listeners, viewers. I greatly appreciate it. Is there anything else? If nothing else, you know, of course, thank you for your time.
Yeah. Thanks for having us, Phil. This was lots of fun.
It's a fun conversation.
Says slavery has to be considered in context. What's more relative than that? There were people at the time, Thomas Paine, Benjamin Franklin, there were innumerable humanists and secularists who said slavery is evil. The church wouldn't agree. Now, which is it then? Is it that the church is wrong, or, even more suggestive, that God has not yet revealed that it's wrong to them? Or did God support it all those years and then change his mind? From a beginning point of absurdity, you arrive at a terminal point of absolute moral chaos. And I think you've at least done us the favor of making that plain this evening. God, in short, God did not make man in his own image. It is precisely to the contrary. Mammals and primates made many gods and many churches in their own rival images.
The Phil Ferguson Show is for educational and entertainment purposes only. Nothing said on the show should be interpreted as personalized investment advice. Investments should be based on your personal situation, and you, of course, should consult with your financial advisor or tax professional before taking any actions. Once again, thank you for listening to The Phil Ferguson Show. Sorry if it's too long, or you're welcome if you like the show really long, but just a couple of thoughts on the follow-up here. The next coming conference is CSIcon, and you can go to csiconference.org and learn all about it if you have not already bought tickets. The two big headliners for this conference is Neil deGrasse Tyson and Brian Cox. There's something like 40 different speakers, but those are the two most famousest ones, which either one would be enough reason to go, right? And again, that's October 24th through 27th of 2024, just about 3 weeks from the release date of this podcast. So make sure you check it out. The conference is in Las Vegas. It's at the Horseshoe Casino. In the early time, the first day, I guess, the 24th, that Thursday, I am hosting, sponsoring, inviting, I guess, people to come to a friend of the show event. Just to be clear that I'm inviting you, but I'm inviting you to pay for your own way. So just make sure we're perfectly clear there. but at 3 o'clock. Again, this is Thursday, October 24th, 2024. At 3 o'clock, we're going to meet at the Fuel Bar, Las Vegas. In the past, I've tried to find a place inside the casino so we could all go together. Now you're on your own. And matter of fact, it's so easy to get to. Right in front of the Horseshoe Casino is an area called the Grand Bazaar Shops on the corner of Flamingo Road and Las Vegas Boulevard. Maybe 50 to 100 different stores there. When you leave the Horseshoe Casino, there's these giant escalators you go down. And as soon as you get to the bottom of them, you turn left and walk, I don't know, 50, 70 feet, and you'll see the Fuel Bar. So we're going to be at the Fuel Bar from 3 until 5. At 5, we're going to walk across the pathway to Wahlburger, and you can have some food at Wahlburger. Again, you're going to pay your own way, but you can join maybe me and two or three other people. Maybe it's 40 people. I'm not taking any list. I'm not collecting names. So it's going to be part of the adventure how many people do or don't show up. You don't have to go to the conference to go to this meet and greet. If you are in or near Las Vegas and you want to deal with transportation to get to the Grand Bazaar Shops, the front of Horseshoe Casino, you can join us. That's fine. The Fuel Bar, usually on weekdays, does specials where you can buy one drink, get one free. So hopefully that will still be the case. And then we'll go over to Wahlburger. The one thing that I will ask people to do, just because large groups, sometimes people get weird. Let's say there's 20 of us. I do not want to have 20 of us walk into Wahlburger and say, we'd like a table for 20 or maybe a table for 40. We don't want to do that. Restaurants have a really hard time with that, especially if it's the kind of restaurant. I don't even know that they take reservations. I don't want to do it because I don't know how many people are going to show up. So at 5 o'clock, we move over to Wahlburger, and please group up, meet some new people. You don't have to sit with me. You don't have to sit with your friends. Sit with random people. It's also a meet and greet. You can find some new friends. And maybe we sit in groups of 4 or 5 or 6, probably no more than that. Maybe groups of 3 if it works for you. And if it really matters to you, let me know and I'll move from table to table a little bit. We'll do that from 5 until 7 p.m. And just to keep in mind, the schedule, there are some, what do they call them? Little early sessions, registrations, workshops. There's a workshop that goes from 2:30 till 4. So if you've signed up for that workshop and you really want to go see that workshop, that's cool. Go to the workshop. And at 4 o'clock, come outside and find us at the Fuel Bar and hang out for an hour or 40 minutes, however quick you can get out there, and then join us over at Wahlburger, right? So you can get a drink, go over to the Wahlburger, we hang out there, 5 o'clock, we get food, maybe stay till 7. And then around 7 is the opening reception for the conference. So those people who are going to the conference, we would want to leave Wahlburger by then or a little bit before then to get to the opening reception. I'm assuming there's some kind of finger food and snacks, but you just ate. So maybe you don't have to be there at 7, but you may want to be there at 7 to meet, again, more people, make new friends. But you definitely want to be there at 8 because that's when the Richard Dawkins Award is being given to Brian Cox, and he does his keynote address at 8 p.m. on the 24th. So I'm trying to fit in best I can without disturbing the conference, without distracting from the other activities you may want to do or engage at the conference. But this is just, I'm going to call it Friends of the Show. Again, Thursday, October 24th, 2024, from 3 to 5 p.m., we are going to the Grand Bazaar Shops. If you don't know where that is, ask any employee in the casino, the Horseshoe Casino. They'll direct you. You go down the escalator, you turn left, and you go over to the Fuel Bar. We'll be there from 3 to 5, and then at 5 o'clock we go to Wahlburger. Small groups, so the restaurant can get us all seated relatively easily. And then we'll go back to the conference 7, 7.15, 6.45, whatever works for you as soon as you have finished your meal and settled up. And please tip generously because we're going to be loud and annoying people. So think of that. But the show is already way longer. I really dream of the shows being an hour, but this is more than an hour and a half, maybe even pushing 2 hours. But thank you for listening. Thank you for sharing. Go check out the video version of the interview and let me know what you think. Otherwise, I will see you at the next podcast, or I will see you at the next conference. And if you do see me, please feel free to come up and say hello. Until then, ciao.
Take no defeat. I will thrive. I will not just survive.
Listen, before I was a Christian, something was missing. Felt a little distant, dark, resistant. Made a decision, got a new vision. Wrote my goals, yeah, wrote my mission. BC, I was aimlessly walking. Then one day I heard the voice of God talking. Rise up, child, to the enemy mocking. Prayer is your weapon. Pray without BC, stopping.
I am the tiger. It's the thrill of the fight. Rising up to the challenge of our rival. With the heart of a lion and the armor of God, you will conquer it all with the eye of the tiger. Face to face with Satan himself. Don't budge an inch, he'll take miles. He'll find your weakness, he will hit where it hurts. Stand your ground, make him run for the hills. It's the eye of a tiger, it's the thrill of the fight. Rising up to the challenge of our rival. If you cast all your cares on him and pray through the night, you will conquer it all with the eye of a tiger. Rising up, straight to the top. Fight for Christ, give him glory. Go the distance, don't retreat, never stop. For the Lord always wins in the end. It's the eye of a tiger, it's the thrill of the fight. Rising up to the challenge of our rival. With the heart of a lion and the armor of God, you will conquer it all with the eye of a tiger.
Keep your eyes on God and your heart in the Word. Be a leader in Christ, don't follow with the herd.
The eye of a tiger.
Always walk by faith, never walk by sight. With the armor of God, you'll never lose the fight.
The eye of a tiger.